Also, we're so blessed, you guys, that we've had somebody in this house for many, many years. And he's a father and he's a grandfather. And his name is Mr. Michael Kerry. And Michael, of course, you know, his story goes way back to England. And so I had asked him, I said, you know what, this is a way to honor you there, Mike, as he has been almost behind the scenes type of a guy for so much of his life here in this fellowship. He is electrician by trade, electrical engineer. And, you know, I think anything that's been touched with lights here has been Mike's signature on it. He's such a blessing. But you know what? He does more than, you know, put two wires together. I mean, Mike is a student of the Word of God. Him and Kathleen are really blessed to have some family, I think, here to with them here today. And so let's give Mr. Mike Kerry a warm welcome as he comes and he shares a little bit on Father's Day.
Good morning, everyone. Well, that's a good start. Thank you. Pastor Ken asked me to speak to you about being a father and being at war. Well, I am a father. With a bit of help from my wife, I had two children. Two lovely girls, and in the course of time, they grew up, and they met and married fine husbands, and they produced for us five grandchildren, three boys and two girls. And in the course of time, they grew up, and four of them are married, and they have produced us five other, the next one down, great grandchildren. Four girls and a boy. So I can say I have got great grandchildren. And I do welcome those of them all that are here this morning. War, it says here, being at war. Coming up in about a week and a half is Canada Day. July the 1st, 2016, and we have a lot to celebrate here. But that happens to be a special day concerning war, because exactly 100 years ago, namely July the 1st, 1916, that was in the middle of the First World War, that was a day called the Battle of the Somme, S-O-M-M-E, and in that battle, the two enemies have been firing at each other for years, and they attacked. And in that day, 150,000 men on each side were killed in one day, and they gained nothing. The amount of land that they achieved from that attack was just about zero. War, as I understand it, is when people invade or fight other people. And it usually involves a lot of brutality. But there is another kind of war, and you may have heard of it, and it's called the drug war. 2 weeks ago, right here, in this corner, we had a baptism. I love baptism. And in that occasion, there were 10 people that got immersed in the tank. And we usually ask them to say a few words about how they got here and what they've experienced and why they've come and what's changed. Two of them were children. There was Carrie Ann, who's 11, and Stephen, who's 12. And four were young women. Some of them are here today. There was Chantal, Ashley, Desiree, and Alexandra. And when they got up to speak, if I heard correctly, at least two of them said that they had been introduced to drugs at a very young age, something like 12 or even younger. And as a father, that bothered me. There's something wrong in that picture. I don't know the circumstances and I don't want to point any fingers, but some bad decisions have been made along the line there. So as a father, what do you think about that? What's the process? Why do children get exposed to drugs? Why do people fight and invade each other? Well, we are a church. We are believers, most of us. We believe in the Word of God, the Bible. So that's where I would look for some answers. And as Pastor Ken said, I'm an engineer. I haven't been to Bible school, but we can all read it and we can all see what it says. And here's a few quick verses, very quick ones. The Bible says, "There is none that is righteous, no, not one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way." My point is that all of us inherit a sinful nature. And we all naturally say, "Me first." That's part of us, the way we come into the world. Even a newborn baby, beautiful. You see this baby, it's got lovely fingernails and eyelashes, beautiful. It's got its mum's eyes and its dad's chin. And in there is all the potential to grow up into a full-blown, handsome, young or old person. That baby also has within him or her a soul, a capacity for sin. It's there. That person can grow up saying "me first" and dependent on all circumstances can turn out to be a bunch of no good. This is the Bible, and I'm convinced from there that God is real. And the Bible says that God is love. And as we've heard this morning, he is the ultimate father. And this is Father's Day. Satan is real. He's the devil. And the Bible says that he is out to steal, kill, and destroy. Heaven is real. And that is indescribably beautiful and everlasting. Hell is real. And that is unspeakably bad and everlasting. And there's no in between. It might be nice if there was, sort of saved, sort of qualified. Admission to heaven is based on belief and not on being good. So, to all of these questions that churn in one's mind when you're exposed to things like I've just described, war and the effects of drugs, there is an answer. And that answer, as we know, is Jesus. Amen. He paid the price for our sin, and we all have sin. And what a price he paid. We can't really fully imagine what crucifixion must be like. But in the process, he has provided us with forgiveness. We can be completely set free from the effects of that sin which is within us. And we can learn to forgive those that trespass against us. He gives us new life, which is what these people described from the tank. He sets us on the way to heaven. We get to have the hope of that, or even the blessed assurance that we're going to go there and it's going to be absolutely wonderful. And we haven't deserved it, but we believe in it, so we qualify for it. There is even prayer. What's that? Well, it's something that we practice, and we in this church believe that God answers prayer. We believe that he heals today, as he did in the Bible stories. He sets people free. And if you want to see some evidence of that, come here on a Friday night and hear what people say, especially people who've been part of that drug culture, who are set free from it and are experiencing miracles, signs, wonders, healings in this place here today on Friday night. Yeah. I think it's wonderful that we can have baptisms and hear what people have to say from that tank. Anyway, so this, my conclusion is that we're in the world, but not of the world. And the world includes drugs and war and much more. As for me, I have zero experience of drugs. I couldn't recognize the smell of marijuana. I'm told that it's got a distinctive... I've never been there, I've never done that, and I'm from a different planet. But I do have some experience of war on a minor scale, not like what I just told you about the Battle of the Somme. I have an uncle that was at the Battle of the Somme, and I've discovered a book in which he is quoted. But that's war at its worst. I've seen a little bit of it. Most of the people who are quoted in this Bible, they had experience of war too. There's lots and lots of stories in the Old Testament and the New. In the New Testament, all of those countries around where Jesus was, Israel, Syria, Lebanon, Turkey, Greece, all those countries, Egypt, they were all occupied at that time by the Romans. The Romans conquered just about the whole of Europe very brutally. They're the ones that invented or used crucifixion to keep people in order. In 55 BC, that was before Jesus came, but not far before, the Romans, led by Julius Caesar, invaded England. I say England, not Britain, because they didn't get into Scotland. And the reason why they didn't get into Scotland was because the people there were too fierce. Just ask Mr. James Tully and Esther and Mr. Bob Goodenough and Isabel and Alistair. If you're Scottish, your country was never conquered. Amongst us today, there is one person that I know of who was raised in a country that was occupied during World War II. Greter, I bless you, and I honor you today. Greter was raised in Holland during a brutal occupation. I was a child in World War II. I was born just before it. And I have some experiences of it. It lasted for 6 years. And I have childhood memories of it. I can remember the sirens going off. And when the sirens went, it meant that we all had to go into the air raid shelters. On the street where I lived, there was an air raid shelter on the sidewalk, a big brick building that was solid. But most of us had one as of our own in the backyard. My dad dug a small hole and then put inside it corrugated iron. And then covered the whole thing with about a foot of dirt. And that was our own air raid shelter. And these air raids would come day or night. And I remember being dragged out of bed and taken down. And my sister was younger in arms. And we would go into this damp, cold, musty place and sit until the all clear went. And there would be people outside called air raid wardens. They would usually be elderly men, because all the young men were not there. They'd gone to fight in the war, and they were there to make sure that we all got into shelters, that all the windows had to be blacked out at night so that no light would escape and attract the aircraft. They also had to make sure that everybody was carrying a gas mask. Can you imagine going shopping and carrying a gas mask? It was necessary. It was just all part of the life. But my family wasn't bombed. We didn't experience any trauma. So I just have a few memories of it. After the war, there was a thing called national service, and all boys or men on reaching the age of 18 were required to go into the armed forces, the Navy, the Army, or the Air Force for 2 years. It's called national service. And that began at age 18. I managed to avoid that because I joined the Navy at age 16. I volunteered, and this is quite a few years after the war. It was 1954. And I signed on till my 30th birthday, which is 14 years. That's quite a commitment to volunteer for. I don't know whether they still do it. I doubt it. Anyway, I served for 21 years. And during my time there, I had no experience of bloodshed or trauma. And I have every sympathy for those that did, and there are many who suffered deeply. I should mention some people that you've probably heard of. Their names are John, Paul, George, and Ringo, the Beatles. I'm a bit older than they, not very much. And they didn't have to do national service, not because they were the Beatles, but because that ended before their time. But I would have had to do national service. So there I stepped, I said goodbye to mum and dad and the dog and the sister and got on a train and went a whole day's journey and was taken to this boot camp. It wasn't called that, but there, anybody that's been in the forces knows that you go there and join up and learn the basics. I'm aware of Vivian, Marika, Maynard, and there are probably others of you who have been there and done that. We were issued with a uniform and weren't allowed to wear anything else but uniform. All our civilian clothes, mine, were all wrapped up in a parcel and mailed back home. And I heard that when the parcel with my clothes in it arrived, my mum burst into tears and the dog went crazy because she smelt me. this is 9 years after the end of the war, but I had to hand in my ration books because everything was rationed still, even all those years after the war. You couldn't go in and buy any food without having your coupons snipped out because it had to make sure that everybody got some, even distribution. You couldn't buy clothes without coupons. And so if there was a girl in the family that was going to get married, it probably took the whole family's coupons for about 3 months to get a wedding dress. And gasoline, we called it petrol, that was rationed, and all of those things were quite severe, so I had to hand him a ration book. And we undertook this training. And that includes marching. You wonder why. Why did they go onto the playground and do all that? And we spent hours and hours and hours on the playground, learning to march, learning to do it properly. And it does look good when it's done well. But there's a purpose for it. While you're on the playground, you find out for sure where you stand in the hierarchy of the service that you're in. You know who your immediate boss is and who he goes to and salutes and reports to, et cetera, et cetera. So you know, everybody knows where they stand, and they also learn instant obedience. If you're in a platoon that's marching, a squad or whatever you call it, and they're told to turn right and you don't instantly obey, then you are the odd one out and cause chaos. So that's sort of what's behind there. And over the years, you do that. And what you learn about is authority. You learn that you are under authority, and that equips you for being in authority. Most of my life, I've been a boss, one way or the other, wherever I rose to in the Navy and then subsequently. And in the church, I'm in leadership here. That is authority. But my way of learning that was on the playground. But it isn't all marching and saluting. There's lots of opportunities. There certainly was for me, for advancement and sports and travel and adventure. Eventually, I went to sea, and I served mainly in aircraft carriers. And I'm going to show you a one-minute video that James is just keying up here, just to paint the picture. Stirs the juices in me, that gets me very excited. Those aircraft weigh 15 or 16 tons, and to have them fired off the front end of a ship or landing on with rested hooks, I can tell you lots of stories. I've seen accidents and things, but it's a dangerous place. In order to do flying operations, the ship turns into wind, which might be 30 miles an hour, and then it goes at full speed, that's another 30. So it's windy on the deck, it's dangerous, and it's noisy, and you have to be well-trained and well-disciplined, but it works. And they're there for a purpose. I'd like to show you now a picture of an aircraft called a Sky Raider. That's an old aircraft, a World War II aircraft, but that ship that we just saw in the previous YouTube, I was on that ship. It was Her Majesty's ship Hermes at the time. This is an aircraft that was on another ship that I was on called a Sky Raider. And it has a pilot in the front that you can see. And then about where the roundel is on the side, it has two men sitting in there at radar stations. And on one occasion, I was flown ashore to do something on a NATO base on the island of Sardinia at a place called Decimomanu, it's near Italy. Anyway, that kind of aircraft doesn't go off by a catapult. It starts at the back of the ship and roars down and gets airborne into that strong wind. Anyway, we went ashore, my assistant and I, and we climbed out and went to do our job, and then the ship's mail was put into the back of the aircraft, mail bags, and that's very important on a ship that's at sea to get letters from mum. And yes, I should mention that an aircraft carrier, the ones I was on anyway, had 3,000 men, and the average age was 20. So they were eager for their mail, and it was strapped into the seats that we had just vacated, and it took off to return to the ship and land on, but it didn't make it. The engine seized up, and it landed in the Mediterranean Sea, and glub, glub, glub down to the bottom. The pilot was safe, he got out, but the aircraft and the mail went to the bottom. That's just one little incident. I was on four aircraft carriers, but I also served on some smaller ships, and I'll show you now a picture of one called HMS, that stands for Her Majesty's Ship, Manxman. It was a World War II ship, and in its former days, it was a fast mine layer. That thing could go at 40 knots, which is about 45 miles an hour. But in my day, in the 1960s, early 60s, it was a minesweeper depot ship. And it was based in Singapore, and I was flown out to Singapore. It took 6 days to get there. And served on that ship for a year away from mum. And there were probably 20 officers and 300 or 400 men. And I was one of the officers, but a very junior one. And we lived in the officer's mess, which is called the wardroom. And it's very stately and very elegant and very formal and very necessary. And the men lived elsewhere, some in hammocks and different mess decks according to where they were. But the officers were mainly heads of departments like navigation and gunnery and engineering, etc. And we were the depot ship for a number of minesweepers. Could you show that one of Fiskerton, James? That's a coastal minesweeper. And there were a dozen of those, and our ship, the Manxman, was a sort of like the mother hen. And we were over in the Far East, and it was at a time of war. You may not have heard of it, but in the early 60s, Singapore, Malaya, Sarawak, and North Borneo, they were former British colonies that were being given independence. They were coming into the Commonwealth, and just to the south of them, there's a big nation called Indonesia. And at that time, that was a communist nation, and they were attacking, they were invading these countries, and we were the good guys defending them. And the minesweepers were able to go into the coastal areas, and the Manxman, the bigger ship, was the depot ship. The officers included the padre. That means, that's Spanish for father, isn't it, Patricia? An Anglican church minister. And we had church services, usually in the outdoors, because this is almost on the equator. It's tropical, it's hot. And so church attendance wasn't compulsory, as it had been at boot camp. You had to go to church there. We had services, and this padre, his name was Noel Jones, a very interesting man, and he would stand with his dog collar and his robes and say, "We are gathered here today in the name of Almighty God," and going through this beautiful Anglican service. And he was just one of the officers there. And we would have, I told you about the wardroom being rather stately and elegant and dignified, and we would have social events when we were ashore alongside in Singapore. And some of the officers had their wives living out there, and otherwise there would be other ladies invited. And there would be cocktails, and there would be meals, and occasionally there would be a dance. And we, of course, being gentlemen, if one wanted to invite a lady to have a dance, he would go over and he would say, "May I have the pleasure of this dance, my dear?" And she would come out. Not, and she wouldn't do that. She would do this. "Thank you, my dear." But this is 1963, and do you remember those four people that I mentioned to you? John, Paul, George, and Ringo. They were leading the world in something a bit different from that. It was, yeah! And among those elegant and stately officers, there was only one who knew how to do that, and it wasn't me. It was Noel Jones. The minister, and he taught us a lot. I'm going to come back to Singapore, but let's just go fast forward 20 years, the 1980s, I can't remember which year. We had left the Navy, emigrated, come to live in British Columbia, lived in a nice house in Aldergrove, and it was a Saturday morning in the summer, and we were about the house doing whatever. And we had the television on, and there was a reason for that. It was because there was a world-famous event taking place, the marriage of Prince Charles to Lady Diana. And that was broadcast worldwide, and that was a very stately and elegant event. Prince Charles was in the Royal Navy, so was I. In fact, we were in the same room together at one time, and I had more stripes on my arm than he had on his. We didn't engage in conversation, but if we had, he would have had to call me Sir, and he's going to be the king. Anyway, here was Prince Charles in his full dress uniform with Princess by his side, Archbishop of Canterbury, all the pomp and glory that Britain is so good at. And it was on the television somewhere, we kept looking at it. And then I heard this voice. We are gathered here today in the presence, and it was Noel Jones. In the meantime, he had risen to become the senior chaplain in the Royal Navy, and he was taking part in the marriage of Prince Charles. But I'm telling you, go back to Singapore now, and that Far East area, during that, it was called a confrontation, but it was a real war. People were getting killed. And as a very, very junior officer, I was put in charge of a boat called a cumpet. Could you change that one, Jane? That's the best picture we could find of a cumpet. It's a locally designed boat, and several of them were commandeered. And I was put in charge of one of them. I was totally in command. And it was in North Borneo, right in the very, very far corner. And it was in coastal waters that are very much like we have here, between here and Vancouver Island. Islands and beautiful scenery. And I had a chart which showed where we all were. And on that chart was a dotted line, and there is one on the dotted line here. If you travel from Tawasan to Victoria, you will go over a dotted line into United States waters and then back again into Canadian waters, because that's what it's like. But there was a dotted line, and on the other side of this border in the water was Indonesia. And 3 miles down there on the other side, there was a coastal port. And my job on this boat was to keep watch on that port and report ship movements. I had a radio. I was the only white man on board. I had 2 Malaysian Navy seamen and 1 mechanic. It had 2 pretty big engines, and that was to run the boat. And I had a platoon of about 8 soldiers called Gurkhas, members of the British Gurkha Regiment, and they are very elite soldiers. They come from the country of Nepal, and that was who we were on that cumpet. And it was there, we were there for a couple of weeks, and I've got tons of stories, but that'll have to be another time. But we were cruising along this dotted line, and I decided to anchor. So we dropped the anchor, and we could relax for a bit. And I sat there under the deck chair, treated like a king. I was the ultimate boss. It's rather nice to have authority sometimes. And then suddenly, noise, bang, splashes. The people on the Indonesian side didn't like where we were, so they started firing at us with mortars and medium machine guns. And it seemed to me like the air was full of lead. That's sort of how you look back on it. But I got them to pull the anchor up and start the engines, and we beetled off away from it. Nobody was hit. We were splashed. Nobody was hurt. So, again, no trauma, but that's my little story of being in the war. Eventually, I was sent home after that year away at sea. I had been away from mum, and I had left her with a girl of 3 and a half called Gail, and a girl of 3 months old called Julie. So when I went back, they were a year older than that. And I arrived back in the middle of the night. And so the next morning, I was lying in bed with mum, and the bedroom door opened, And in came a little 4.5-year-old girl with a toddler holding by the hand. The toddler's other hand was in her mouth. And they came up to the bed, and they had been living in a city in England that has a real rough accent, and kids pick up accent. And Gail said to me, "Hello, you must be my daddy. My name's Gail, and this here's my sister. She's called Julie." So daddy came home.
In that year when Mike was away, I was, you know, I missed him terribly. And the only thing that kept me alive with him was his letters. And one day I got a letter and a photograph. And here he was, all laid out to dry, all lovely and tan, and reading a James Bond. And I thought to myself, and here am I walking the floor with my babies. You know, Julie was very bad in cutting her teeth. And I was walking the floor, and I'm thinking, well, why on earth did he send that for? That made me so upset. That I thought to myself, when he comes back, I'll say, here's your babies. I am going to relax and you're walking the floor. Got it? Yes. So, I mean, that's what he was like, you know? And he lost so much weight, you know, kept running to make sure that the planes were working, because that's what he was doing, and the ships. And I'm thinking, because his boss said to me, we were in Malta at the time, we had an opportunity to go to Malta, and there was 5 wives that went out. And as we were waiting for the men to come, we went down to the quay. And his boss says to me, you won't recognize Mike. I says, why not? Well, he's got the longest beard. And he said, he's been run off his feet, and he's been just a blessing to us. And sure enough, I didn't recognize Mike. You know, he had a big black beard, yeah. And, you know, here he was. And I thought, do they feed you? And he said, I didn't have time. I had to keep running all the time. So that's how he lost his weight.
Oh, praise the Lord. All right, so anyway, thank you so much there. Let's give Mike a hand. Isn't that beautiful? Just wonderful. And so we have amazing men and women of God here, and we just wanted to honor, you know, Mike's leadership here over the, I don't know, 15 plus years. Has it been 20 years that they've been serving here in this valley, in the city? And there's lots of others that are just as content to be behind the scenes, but understand that being as an authority, as he talked about, the officer that he was. And so we're so blessed to have there's a price they pay for our freedom. And here we are here today. As Mike had said there, I mentioned here, we're talking basically about war, but there's another war. And this war that we're fighting, Joshua chapter 24. So let's go to Joshua 24. At least we'll be able to encapsulate a little bit of the scripture verse that you see on your bulletin head there. Joshua chapter 24, and there's a scripture verse that's become one of our favorites for Shar and I, and it deals with just not ourselves, but it deals with actually the generation that follows after. And there was another warrior, his name was Joshua, and he followed after the heels of Moses. Moses was his mentor, and then here was Joshua, who was asked, you know, again, to give leadership under our Heavenly Father, and he was a successor there to Moses, and he talked about wars that he fought. Now, interesting that of the wars that this man was involved in, he was a warrior with a capital W. Of the 24 battles, major wars that Joshua was in, he won 23. So, I mean, this guy had a lot of trophies in his shelf, that's for sure. Only one battle that he lost, and it wasn't him actually responsible for the loss of that. There was some stuff that was going on in his camp, and a little leaven leavens the whole lump. And then once that was revealed, then he got rid of that. So, I mean, really, you know, his batting average was almost 100%. But it tells us in verse 11 of Joshua 24, it says, "Then you went over the Jordan, and you came to Jericho, and the men of Jericho fought against you also." And then it gives a list of all these Ituses. It says the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Girgashites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. And every one of them actually was an actual group of people that he fought against. And so he would remember, as an example, the Jebusites. And interesting, the Bible says that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places. Very, very, it's a very present day battle. We still have Perizzites here today. You said, "I've never heard of a Perizzite." It's the name that it went by that, you know, in that day. But the Perizzite is responsible. That spirit that was behind that group of people hasn't died. It's still around here today. You know, we were talking a little bit about the drug culture, the drug war. And if we had time, which we don't, we could talk about, you know, what the Jebusite actually represented, what the Amorites represented. And there's a real war. It's a real war, perhaps invisible. We're not sure how to fight that. We don't fight it with guns and swords and spears, but we fight it in prayer. And we have been winning the battle. We've been winning the battle. And we just praise God. Because there are men in this house today, and there are men that know how to pray. And we have a video that we'd like to show you. James, do we have that powerful video that just happened recently? Not just men, but men are a part of this, from Lou Engle.
In 1997, Promise Keepers put 1 million men on the Mall to pray for America, an historic event in church history. And I begin to declare the hearts of the fathers are turning to the children, and there's coming a corresponding movement of the young people turning to the fathers. I had no idea what was being launched. It led to a supernatural series of events that on September 2nd, into the new millennium, 400,000 young people gathered together for 12 hours to cry out to God. It launched the movement of the call, and now we're 16 years into that movement. I always knew that the call was some kind of like a John the Baptist type movement. Because it was about fasting and prayer and Nazarites, and it was about turning America back to God. It was after this that I began to ask the question, has the call failed? Because we haven't seen America turn back to God. And the Lord spoke to me when I asked that question. And he said, "Lou, if it truly was a John the Baptist type movement, you can bet there's a Jesus movement coming. It's another massive baptism of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we're dreaming about." For 3 years, we began to pray stadiums would be filled. So I call my friend and I tell him this story. And he says, "Lou, do you remember my dream that I had?" He says, "In the dream, I received 5 sets of 5 plane tickets. And in the dream, we could only fly united." And he knew it had to do that the church must unite, because only a united church can heal a divided nation. He said, "I was so concerned that I would miss the expiration date. And it was in 1,080 days the tickets expired. I wake up from the dream, look up 1,080 days from the dream. Guess what day it is? It's April 9, 2016, the 110th anniversary of the Azusa Street Revival. From that moment on, I've known that God has a date with his church." As we're praying this, my friend and I, we actually go to the Memorial Coliseum in Los Angeles, and somehow they let us get in there, and we claim it for Stadium Christianity. Then I get an email from a young lady in Washington State. She says, "I had this dream. I saw this huge stadium, and it was both a football field and it was a baseball field. It was so vivid." She said, "I woke up and I Googled to see if there was any stadiums that was both the Super Bowl and the World Series." She said, "There's only one. It's the Colosseum in Los Angeles. I think you're supposed to do the Call of Zeus there. So I was convinced in my heart that God wanted to do the stadium, but I just didn't have faith to raise the kind of money that it would cost to buy the field. I was reading Matthew 13, and it says, when a man finds a treasure, he goes and hides it in a field and sells all that he has to buy that field with joy. You know, there just comes a time when you just want something more than anything else. For me, my calling has been revival for 40 years. And I would rather get revival than anything else except my own kids loving Jesus. And I sense the Lord said, sell the house to buy the field, the stadium, for the treasure of the unity of the body of Christ and for revival. This is not about some huge thing that I'm doing. I could care less if anybody knows about it, but I want revival. And I think we're at a point in America that everybody's got to begin to ask the question, how much do we really want God in America? Maybe it's time for the whole body of Christ to buy the field, to sell out for the greatest outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I believe in the next year we will begin to see the greatest awakening America has ever seen. And we won't just talk about the past, we'll talk about the future, a new Jesus movement, a new Azusa Street. Come, not just join us, let's work together, mobilize, and move this thing across the earth. We're not going for an event, we're going for a massive breakthrough. It's not just Azusa then, it's Azusa now.
And you know what, that's a few days away. That's gone, that's past, but how many believe for revival today in the nation of Canada? When he says America, we say North America, we say United States, Canada, and around the world that we're going to see a move of God. But it's not ever, ever going to happen without prayer, without a mobilization of prayer. And as he mentioned at the beginning of that is when men filled the stadium. I was in there in Seattle, Washington, where 63,000 men showed up to say, we want to pray, we want to stand in the gap for our nation. And as a result of that, we've got some young people in the last 3-4 years that as a result, they've given their hearts completely over to Jesus Christ. And so we are just so thankful that there's more in our city, in our cities, in our regions, all across this nation of Canada, praise God. So let's all stand up. And what we're going to do is we're going to invite the Holy Spirit. If there's those of you that want prayer, we're closing a little bit early so you can get to your restaurants or wherever it is that you've got to go. But we want to make mention of this is that we got a busy, busy week this week. We have meetings all throughout this week, but starting the Awakening Revival meetings on Friday night. Again, bring your friends, bring people that don't know Jesus. This man is a revivalist, and then we've got all throughout the weekend, Friday and Saturday, as well as on Sunday. And we're trusting by the grace of God that we're going to have many, many more water baptisms that are going to come as a result of people giving their lives to Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray today that, Lord God, that if there are those that were just hearing this story about this war that is pending upon us and our nation, Lord, we have a culture war. We've got a war dealing with abortion, with euthanasia, infanticide. We have a war, Lord God, where they're not allowing prayer in our schools. Lord, we're in war. And Father, we don't fight with flesh and blood, but the war we fight is with on our knees. It's in prayer. Because your word said, if my people called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek your face, turning from our own unrighteousness and iniquity, that, Lord, that you would hear our hearts and that, Lord, you would forgive us and that you would heal Canada. Lord, that flag, every time we see it, Lord, waving in the atmosphere reminds us of Revelation 22 and verse 2. That, Lord, the healing was, that flag, Lord, is like the leaf, Lord, for the healing of the nations. And so, Lord God, we pray, let a healing touch the nation of Canada in the political scene, in the educational scene, in our business sector. Lord, from coast to coast, may the founding fathers, their motto, his dominion shall be from sea to sea. Let it manifest in our day and in our generation, that we will see more people coming out, Lord God, of the corridors of darkness, translated into the kingdom of your dear Son, Jesus. We declare, Father, that Jesus Christ is Lord over Canada. Let's just say that together. Jesus is Lord over Canada. One more time. Jesus is Lord over Canada. Father, let that, Lord God, come forth with action. That, Lord, we will do what you've called us to do. And we bless you and we thank you, Lord, for that in Jesus' precious name. And everybody said, amen. Amen.